Hi, my name's Nichole. Growing up was really difficult for me. I was put into many situations that I shouldn't have been as a child. Some of those situations included sexual abuse and physical abuse. Around the age of 10, my mom took us four kids and left my dad without his knowledge. They call it kidnapping. After 3 months, my dad had been trying to find us, and he found us. We happened to be at school when he found us. So in the middle of the main hall by the principal's office, there had to be 10, 15 sheriff officers around. And across from me, there's my dad screaming, "Come to me, come to me, come to me." And my mom's behind me trying to hold us back, calling my dad every name in the book, saying, "You can't take my babies, you can't take my babies." And sheriff's officers had us all saying, choosing. We're kids, we're 10 and under at that time, wanting us to choose which parent to go to. After everything happened in the school, we all ended up going back to Memphis, and my dad got full custody of all of us kids. My dad's not an affectionate man whatsoever, and so there weren't many hugs or I love you. There were no I'm proud of you. I needed someone to tell me that they loved me and that I was wanted and that they were proud of me to feel, you know, good. All kids do. Getting close to my 14th birthday, I met a boy who did tell me all those things that I so desperately needed. He told me if I gave him what he wanted, he would love me and I'd be worth something and that I would be good. And I did. I gave myself to him. And at 14 years old, I was pregnant with my first child. About 2 months after that, we moved to Colorado to be with my mom. Did not know at all that my mom had ever struggled with alcoholism. We found out pretty fast that that was there. Everyone knew, even though she would hide it, she would make us hide it. Everyone knew. If someone was coming over, if they knocked on the door, she'd say, "Hang on." And we all knew that our role was to run around the house and gather up her bottles of beer and hide them under this one specific cabinet. And then on trash day, we would have to clean out the cabinet. And we always had minimum 3 bagfuls of 40-ounce bottles of beer. On top of the alcoholism, she was also diagnosed with manic depressive. So while drinking, she was still taking medicine, and at this time she was taking Prozac. We never knew who we were gonna get when she woke up. Many times, we just did things we weren't necessarily comfortable with, but we knew if we didn't do them, the emotional barrage and even sometimes physical violence would happen. And I had to protect me at the time, because at the time I was pregnant with my second child. And I knew then and there, for me, that was the last straw. I could no longer do this. During all of the struggles between, you know, my dad, the divorce, my mom, and where she was at during that time, I always wondered, what was it about me that they couldn't love me like a child was supposed to be loved? Every little girl dreams, at least what I remember, dreams of who their husband was going to be. And I was always going to have a cowboy. And I met David at a party. I actually saw him standing there. He had his hat and his boots on. I knew that was my cowboy. Matter of fact, I took him away from another girl. Pretty fast, we got married. I left everything I knew to come out here where I didn't know anyone but Dave. And then I had two little boys I had to raise. It was a struggle to raise two kids on my own. I felt like while Dave worked, it was my job to raise my boys. Every mistake they made, it made me feel like that I was less than, that I wasn't a good enough mom. Every fight me and Dave had, I wasn't a good enough wife. Couldn't do anything good enough. All of those little bits of, "You're not good enough. You didn't do it right. You failed at your job. it built up and it built up and it built up till it got to a point where I could no longer cope. And I quit sleeping because of these voices. So I was placed on sleep medication. It helped quiet the voices and I was able to sleep. I didn't like being alone anymore. I didn't like being still. There was always, always voices in the quiet. So I started using the medication during the day to keep those voices quiet. I knew, I told myself, if I have a problem, I have a problem if I drive while on this medication. And I did. I drove with Macy in the truck one day. I'm not even quite sure how I made it home. Once I woke up from all of that and I remembered those bits and pieces, I knew right then and there I had a problem. It just ate at me. It ate at me and it ate at me. And I knew I had to say something to Dave. But when I told Dave, I begged him. I said, please don't tell anyone. I can't take it. I can't handle it if you tell anyone. And I knew I was placing a very heavy burden on his shoulders. But finally, I told Dave, I knew it's time. I knew for me to beat this, I had to be honest about it. And being honest about it was sharing it with someone else. And I did. Me and Dave sat down with friends and I told them where I was at and what I had been doing. And I took the pills and I flushed them, every single one of them. Something inside me, just there was so much relief from being away from that, from not being like my mom, because all I did was work so hard to not be my mom. My mom ended up passing 2014, right after my struggle with the pills. And it wasn't easy. It really wasn't until I watched a movie. Can I mention the movie?
Yeah, go for it.
It wasn't during all this time, the voices are just, they keep going on. They keep going on. There's so much pain and hurt there that I needed to go through. And it wasn't till one night I was by myself. I think Dave was on a leader's retreat. And yeah, I hate being by myself. I was watching Inside Out. It was the part where it talked about it's okay for your happy memories to have a sad tinge to them. That something inside me let go. And when I mean let go, I sobbed and I cried and snot ran for, had to be a good 20 minutes that I just sat there and released all of this. It was just like a puzzle piece just stepped into place. And I felt God's love and His healing through all of that. And I knew He was right there with me. He was right there with me during it. And then on, I was able to start replacing those ugly voices with truths about who I am and who I'm supposed to be and what my worth is. I have been able to sit still and be okay with being still. As a matter of fact, sometimes I crave the silence now, because in that time, I'm able to center myself and really have good conversations with God. I'm sharing my story because for me, it was another step in my healing process. I knew in the end that it was no one's words that were gonna make me feel worth it, that I had to put all of my trust in Him and all of my love in Him, His grace, to know that I was worth something, that I was special, and that I was loved.